tell you what, you guys look like they were measured by Chris, Ben, and Peter.
Your life is telling each other.
You need something?
No, I'm good.
I hear people are dying to do business with you.
They are.
Williams and Lauren McDonald. The incumbent was not able to make it due to a prior engagement. We'll go on with the debate as is. Be on the lookout for one of these. Should be handed out to you soon. It's your scorecard for the evening. This will be your opportunity to tell us how you think the debate went. Please only take one, fill one out, if not more than one. When the debate is over, one of our volunteers will come through and collect it. It'll be either myself or one of the other executive committee members will recognize us. I'd like to thank everybody for coming out. We are a little low on time, so hopefully you remember the rules. The debate hasn't changed, same format. With that, I'm going to move everything over and hand it off to Michael McNeely, our debate moderator. Thank you, Michael.
Well, thank you for those of you all that have stayed tonight. That's the majority of the room. And I mentioned to a few people tonight that there's such a big difference between these debates and the U.S. Senate debates. You know, in these debates, you've got less candidates and you get a lot more questions to pose to the candidates and get good, thorough responses for you all to consider. who you will vote for versus the U.S. Senate debate, seven candidates, and we have been lucky to get 5 to 6 questions per debate. So you're fortunate here. Without further ado, we'll go ahead and get started. And each candidate will have an opportunity for an opening statement. I want to make sure I point out our timekeeper in the front, if you raise your hand. She has a yellow card that she'll hold up, giving you a warning that your time is just about up. And then she will raise the red card if you're still talking, your time is up. I also want to remind you that during the questioning, you do have an opportunity for rebuttal. You don't have to use it, but I want to let you know that it is there available for you. And we'll get through as many questions as we can between now and approaching 9 o'clock. So that will start the opening statements, and we'll just start with the closest person to me, and that's Michael Williams, your opening statement.
Well, thank you, Michael. I really like your first name there. First of all, thank all of you as well for being here, the GOP for putting this on. I also want to thank my family. I have my mom, my wife, my kids, all of them here supporting me, so thank you so much for coming out. One of the questions that I'm asked the most as I'm out knocking on doors and meeting people is, why in the world would I want to put myself through this? All of the allegations, the rumors, all that kind of good stuff, everything that comes along with politics. As I've been out there, I've been reminded of a guy who most of you probably know named John Hancock. He was the first signer of the Declaration of Independence. He wasn't a politician to start out with. He was a successful businessman. But he grew tired of the British, their taxes, their regulations, and their fees. And they got to the point where he was fed up with it. That was one reason he signed it so big on the Declaration of Independence. He wanted King George to see his signature without his glasses on. That's why I am running today. I am fed up as well with our federal government and government intrusion into our lives. I am a relatively young guy, but I've already had 3 times where the federal government has intervened or impeded my ability to provide for my family. I am tired of the lack of representation. In fact, the fact that Jack Murphy's not here tonight kind of infuriates me. He's been our senator now for almost 12 years and doesn't have the audacity to show up tonight. This is the second time that we've had a debate and he's not shown up. My campaign has issued a request to his campaign, tell us the time, the date, and the place, and we will be there to debate. In fact, we set up a website called whereisjackmurphy.com. Please go there and voice your opinions as well, because I, for one, am tired of it. Again, my name is Michael Williams. I'm running for state senate here in District 27.
Thank you. Thank you, Michael. My name is Lauren McDonald III. I'm running for candidate for Senate District 27. I want to thank the Republican Party. I want to thank you for being here today, taking the time out of your busy schedule, staying here late. And I know that people have agendas and places to go, but it matters that you're here. It matters to me. I too, like Michael, it does infuriate me that a senator knows that this is a season, an election season, that he chooses not to be here, knowing they rush through the session to get here so that they campaign, but he too chooses not to be here to debate and talk to the citizens of this community. I'm tired of the status quo. It's time to make a difference. It's time for you to be represented down at the state capitol. I'm a father. More importantly, I'm a daddy. I have 3 kids in the Forsyth County school system. 2 are here tonight. Wiley and Ridley, please stand. Very proud of them, and I appreciate them being here to support me. I do have a 6-year-old. My wife had to stay home with her because she doesn't react too well in the morning going to school. But as a business owner in this community, I drive to work every day. I ride the roads. I feel your pain driving on Highway 20, on Highway 9. No, I don't have to drive on 141 because I do live in the center corridor of this community. It's time to make a difference and get our road money, get our road straight, and so that you too, as citizens, can get to and from work. I sit in the traffic. It is painful. For the past 18 years, I've worked just like you to get good people elected to office. It's time to replace our current senator and get someone that's going to represent you down at the Gold Dome. I ask for your vote, your support, and I covet your prayers. Thank you.
Okay, well, we'll get to the first question, and Michael led with the opening statement, so Lauren, you have the first question.
Define in your own words what you believe are Republican values. Tell us what you have done in the last 4 years to promote this value or to help, and or to help the Republican Party.
Well, the Republican values, it started at home with me as a young man. My folks instilled in me the values starting with family. I do that today with mine. I think that's where it all starts. That's where we've gotten off base in our communities is the principles that we were raising a lot of people in this room. And we need to get back there today. The tax burden that's been placed on us, I feel it every day in my own personal business. And we need to change that. I look back at my years. I did serve this community as your coroner for 12 years. I worked every day with my budget and giving back to this community. No, you never, you know, the county fathers never say thank you or have, you know, let people know in the community. But my last year's coroner, I gave back 19% of my budget. And I worked hard to strive for that. So, you know, that I think that's one of the most important things is, as a Republican, is look how that we can get back some better control, get control back in our local communities. Thank you.
For to me, it's life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And every day, our government takes more and more of that away. As far as what I've done, I have built a business over 8 years. I would go out and buy out businesses that were failing. I created jobs, and not only that, but several of the people I employed had a Democrat nature. So I had the opportunity to sit down with them and share with them our Republican values and why we felt so strongly about those values. My father had an opportunity to share with my children. I participated here in the community. We sponsored several cheerleading functions as well as baseball and softball leagues. I'm done.
Michael, you had the opportunity to lead this on this next question.
I hope I'll do better this time.
Tell us one bill that was passed by the Georgia Senate last year that you disagreed with, why you disagreed with it, and what you would have done differently.
Well, this past year, it was an election year, so not too much actually got done. There weren't too many people that wanted to stick their necks out there, so not really too many things that I disagreed this year. However, last year, 2013, there were quite a few. The hospital bed tax, HB 198, which allowed for Obamacare navigators to come into our state, which promoted, obviously, Obamacare. It's also set up the exchange. So those are two that I would oppose.
And what might you have done differently?
I wouldn't have voted for him.
Actually, I look back at what went on a couple years ago with the hospital bed tax. I think we've been taxing them, how they've changed our structure going from the ad valorem tax and how we pay for our vehicles this time. It's wrong. It has become more of a tax burden on us as citizens. And as we talk about what we would pass, I want to also mention what I would pass. This past year when the Senate did not pass the cannabis oil bill. That was sad. That was sad for our children. That was sad for the children that needed that passed. And it's easy to talk about what we didn't pass, but what should have gone down when they played politics with that bill. It was a sad day in the Georgia State Senate that it did not get passed, because I, as a former medic and a fireman for 25 years, there were many calls that I went on that I might not have had to make that call if that bill would have been passed. So, you know, it's, you know, they attached something to it, and of course it shut it down. And I just still look at, you know, the leadership in the state Senate did not push that through, because it had passed a couple times in the House, as Mark said earlier. And so, you know, when we look at things, I think that we want to change. I think we need to look forward to what we should have done.
Start with you on this next question. Should Common Core be stopped in Georgia? Why or why not?
Yes, it should. But you know, before we stop Common Core, we need to get back, we need to abolish the federal Department of Education, period. I think that's where we need to work from the state level up and work with our other states to abolish that form of government. You know, yes, when we look at Common Core, I struggle even at my own home. The math that my kids bring home, I don't know how to do it. I wasn't a great math student, but I did know what 1 + 1 meant. Now 1 + 1 + 5 - I don't get it. And so it's something that we really need to look at. There's got to be a standard that has to be set. I know that. I know that we have to gauge our students so that we're compared between other states and where our kids are going in education. But in Forsyth County, we're so lucky to have the educational system and the superintendent and our leaders that we're jealous all over the state of what we've got here. But as far as Common Core, it needs to be stopped now.
Yeah, I agree wholeheartedly with that. Our federal government has no place in our classrooms. We need to eliminate Common Core. Again, I'm sad to see that the SB 167 wasn't passed, as which would help move that forward. One of the things that kind of I struggle with when it comes to Common Core is no textbooks. My children will come home from school and need some help with their subject, and again, I don't remember a lot of this stuff, so I have to go back and look it up, and there's nothing there for me to look up. So the fact that we don't have any textbooks is also, the questions, math that's being taught today is not the same math that I grew up on. So we need to make sure that our parents are engaged and that our teachers are there as well. So definitely anti-Common Core.
The next question, Michael. From the point of view of your district, what do you think is the most important issue to the voters, and how will you advocate for this issue in the general assembly?
On a very high level, I think one of the biggest concerns that people in our district have is a lack of representation. They feel like their voice is not heard. Again, evidence of our state's senator not being here. One thing that I promise to do is to be very accessible on all the mailers that we send out. I include my cell phone number on our webpage, on our Facebook page. I'm committed to being one of the most accessible state senators, state legislators out there. Also, when we first talked about transportation, our road system here in the Atlanta area, especially in Forsyth County, is horrendous. It's offensive to me just to travel 400 to see how that road goes from 4 lanes to 2 lanes almost immediately at our county lines. We need to do more to promote or to improve our transportation. Also, this Castleberry thing going on. Why they want to spend $12 million building Castleberry when we have other roads such as Mullinax and Post Road that need work on. So those are some issues.
You know, I think one of the big things is, of course, Obamacare, the intrusion into our lives that the federal government is placing on us. I personally was affected by this. As I have a passion of being a firefighter. I did it for 18 years in this community. I was a shift worker. And this past year, they abolished that program because of Obamacare. So my passion of serving you in a very tough job, a very stressful job, was impeded with Obamacare. As I travel around meeting with people, a lot of the issues that people have are local issues. With zoning, people. I just don't think people are being represented. You go down. I've stood in neighborhoods as I've walked around from door to door, and people show me the clear cutting that's going on. That needs to change. We need to have a voice that works with local government, not micromanage it. That's not the job of a state senator to micromanage local government. But local government has to be responsible to y'all out there, citizens. And it's time that happens, because what's going on with the roads that even Michael talked about a few minutes ago, we've got to make a difference. We've got to get some road money. You look at the money that we're taxed on that leaves this county in the small percentage that's given back. We got to change that. We got to make that pie a lot larger for us. And I promise that's something I'm going to work on strongly down at the state capitol as your next senator.
Can I tack on?
Or both? Yes.
Yeah. Kind of what I was talking about as far as the tax dollars. I don't know how many of you know, but the way the state of Georgia collects and sends out the road tax dollars, they collect it up to a big pool, and then it's sent out across the state by congressional districts, which means that the districts up in the northeast corner and southwest corner get the same amount of money as us here in Forsyth County. To me, that's not right. That's one of the things that definitely needs to be changed. We need to become a receiver county instead of a donor county.
I think it's with what Michael's saying, that you look at who's leading the transportation in the state house. That money, the transportation committee chairman it lives in Osceola. You drive, which listen, his job is to bring money to his community. They need, if they've had roads built to nowhere down there. You go to Osceola, you go to Butler, you go to the Bonaire. Those are roads to nowhere. They have got to send us some help up here. They need to come ride our roads. Every time we have someone come speak at our Rotary Club, which is a morning club, they feel our pain coming to here, and we know they feel it going back to Atlanta. So that's something that that we need to make a difference with.
All right, next question. Start off with Lauren. The state of Georgia, in some national assessments, ranks 50th regarding ethics rules and enforcement. What changes need to be made?
Well, ethics starts here. Ethics starts with a person, as y'all sit here tonight, who you want to decide to be your next senator. That's where ethics start. You know, looking at our state ethics commission, it needs to be an autonomous department, not answering to the governor, not answering to the legislature. It needs to be independent with its own budget and its own people making decisions on ethics reform. I do support stronger ethics reform. You know, we keep pouring money into these departments without fiscal responsibility, and it's time to change. We all get back to the good book, the Bible. That's where ethics starts. I think that's if we get back and look at our personal selves and how we elect the people and with no agenda, I think that's when we're going to start getting good people to represent each and every one of you out there.
Yeah, ethics here in this state is atrocious. Last year, there was an ethics bill that was passed that several state legislators touted as, you know, great ethics reform. To me, that's not necessarily reform. What all they did was cap how much a lobbyist can give an elected official, and then they put the onus of reporting that, how much money was given, on the lobbyist, not on the elected official. So if there was some breach, the lobbyist got more trouble than the elected official. There needs to be more accountability. Also, the state ethics board. I know previously Mark Hamilton mentioned that they have plenty of money to do what they need to do. I strongly and adamantly disagree with that. I feel like the state ethics board has been, their legs have been cut out underneath them with the defunding that they've received. And one thing that I strongly support is submitting bank statements with your financial disclosures. I'm a CPA, and the very first time that I prepared my financial disclosures, I had my Excel spreadsheet, had it all listed out, my bank statements, my invoices, my receipts, and ready to submit. I called up my consultant and said, okay, so what do I need to send you? He goes, just send me your Excel spreadsheet. Like, just my Excel spreadsheet, how do you know this is right? We trust you. Ethics does come from here, but there needs to be a level of accountability so that we can see and know what's going on.
Michael, would you support a flat tax or a similar alternative to the current income taxing structure in Georgia? Why or why not?
Yes, I would, not necessarily the flat tax, but I would support eliminating the state income tax. The state of Georgia has the highest state income tax here in the Southeast. We're even higher than Michigan and Illinois. That's a shame to me. We need to move more towards a consumption-based tax model. I know that's not going to be easy. There's actually a site you can go to that you can play with the state's budget, figure out how much money we need to bring in with the sales tax, and it becomes pretty complicated making all those budgets or those numbers balanced. But by doing that, it makes us look at where we're spending our money. I don't think the issue is we don't have enough money. I don't think we're spending it in the right ways and there's enough accountability for it. So changing our tax code, I think, again, would be a mechanism to help us look at where we're spending money as well. But I definitely support changing it.
I think, you know, you hear all the different, the 999 plan, the fair tax, flat tax. We got to make a change. And the change that we got to start with is abolishing the IRS. We've got to have a constitutional convention. and starting with abolishing the 16th Amendment. I think that's where it's going to start. We can't start having all of these overlays laying over our current tax plan. I mean, you cannot operate under this current tax code that we have to deal with every day. So, you know, as far as the consumption tax, yes, that is a fair tax that balances out for even those that aren't paying into our tax digest. So, you know, we can sit here and say that's going to be best, but until we abolish the IRS and send a message to Washington, I think that we're going to be stuck with what we have.
Honorable sir, will you hear this question? As a freshman senator, how will you work with other senators across the state to accomplish your goals and represent the citizens of Forsyth County?
Well, my first job is to represent the citizens of Forsyth County, period. As I chose to offer myself to y'all, I had many senators call and the calls were really different. They talked about, we have a caucus rule, and our caucus rules, we have to support the incumbent. That was disturbing to me. It was disturbing as their incumbent didn't even want to take the time to be here and talk to y'all today. And that's who the senators down there want to support, somebody that doesn't want to represent you. So, you know, as I told one of the senators, I said, y'all ought to have caucus rules that say we're not going to have infidelity. We're going to be fiscally responsible. We're going to represent the state of Georgia in our best way. Those are caucus rules that I feel that they ought to have in the Georgia State Senate. I promise you, when I get down there, I'm going to represent with moral character. And how I raise my children, how I run my business, that's how I want to represent each and every one of you at the state capitol in the Georgia Senate.
I'm a little bit different than most of your politicians. I don't like to talk. I would prefer to listen. And that's one of the things that I'm going to do probably the most whenever I'm down at the Golden Dome, if elected by you guys, is to go down there and to listen to my fellow legislators, as well as listen to you guys. Again, I've never been involved in politics before. I know I have a lot to learn. I've learned quite a bit over the past 9 months that I've been doing this, but I feel like listening is gonna be my biggest asset. Just listening to what I'm gonna do.
Mike, will you lead on this question? If you were given the opportunity to reconsider the 2014 budget, what changes would you make?
Hold on just 1 second. Well, I apologize, I can't find my notes, I have it. But I was actually looking over it this morning, and some of the things that I noticed with the Department of Corrections, they spend about 12% of what we spend in education. To me, that doesn't make any sense. For every 8 child I educate, I take care of one criminal. Also, earlier today we talked about Medicare, Department of, I think it's Human Resources or something like that. $6 to $12 billion is what we spend on that. Again, education is only 9, so we're 40% higher that we're paying for medication. There's a lot of waste, I feel like, in our budget and money going places that it shouldn't be going.
I think, again, looking at the budget, you know, one of the only responsibilities of the legislature is to balance it. Okay? Yes, we can go down there and have all these minutia laws that we pass, but the sole responsibility of the state legislature is to pass a balanced budget. I think we always do that because that's what we have to do. But at the end of the day, I think we need to start looking at across-the-board cuts. You know, as we've been through the recession, and everybody was cut. Now as we see things going back, we need to stabilize. We don't need to spend. Now that we have to start having money in our coffers, we don't need to say, oh, now that we got it, let's spend it. Because that's a habit. I can't do it in my personal business. I have to make cuts in my family as my kids get older and older. they require more. I mean, there's more activities. There's, you know, there's all, you know, things you need at school. And so if you've got to do it, and we've got to do it in our own personal households, we've got to teach our leaders down at the state capitol to do the same.
Yeah, I completely disagree. I do not feel like the primary responsibility of a state legislator is to balance the budget. I think it's to make sure that the citizens get what they pay for in their taxes. And if just spending what comes in is all I have to do, that's pretty easy. I want to make sure that you're getting the value for your taxes and that we're spending it the right way.
Well, unfortunately, that is the law. You have to balance the budget. No, the federal government doesn't. That's why we need to make a change there. We should send a message. They should look at what we have to do in Georgia. But state law says you have to balance the budget. That's the only thing you have to do as a representative or a senator. Is about that is required by law when you convene for the session.
All right, Lauren, you'll lead on this question. What is your position regarding the Convention of State Students?
Well, to tie in just what we said, I think that we need to have a convention of states. I mean, it's important to the future of our nation. We need to send a message, just as I talked about, showing what we do in Georgia, showing how we balance the budget every year, because it is the law. The 16th and 17th Amendment, you heard about it earlier. That's how we're taxed. We need to change it. We talked about a few minutes ago, flat tax, fair tax. We need to abolish the IRS, period. And of course, the 17th Amendment, we as a state need to elect our state senator, U.S. senators, and send a message so that they represent us as a state. Yes, the Congress will represent, be still elected by the people, but our U.S. senators should be elected by our Senate and House. And so by repealing the 16th and 17th Amendment, I think that'll be important for the future of the state of Georgia and our nation.
Lauren has mentioned several times that it's a constant, the state has to balance the budget. And that's a fair statement. However, the term balanced budget doesn't really go along with what the state of Georgia does. To me, a balanced budget is bringing in the same amount of money that you expend. The state of Georgia brings in about $20 billion in revenue, but they expend about $40 billion. The remainder comes from the federal government. Again, that is not a balanced budget. It's just by the way they've defined it, it is, but in actuality, it's not. As far as the Constitutional Convention, I am in 100% support with that. One of the things that we need to do as a nation is strengthen our states. The states are what's supposed to keep the federal government in check, and that's not what's happening. So by having the convention of the states, like you said, we can repeal the 16th Amendment, we can repeal the 17th Amendment, and we can put a balanced budget amendment in there. But we have to do things to strengthen the states, because no matter who we elect a U.S. senator, it's only going to be one voice in the seat of about 150. We need our states to step up and be strengthened.
Michael, if elected, how will you stay in touch, you know, with the concerns of your constituents?
As I've already mentioned, one of the things that I've committed to doing is being extremely accessible. So again, my phone number, my email address, all of that is public information. I can mail it out, so anybody wants to get a hold of me can. Also, there's a few things out there called Twitter and Facebook. I know there's a couple of state senators and legislators that use Twitter to communicate with their constituents. They let their constituents know what they're going to vote for, why they're going to vote for it. I think that is a great idea. That's something I'm learning. Twitter, I haven't quite mastered that yet, but that's something I'm committed to doing, is to staying in touch as however my constituents want to hear from me. That's how I'm going to learn to already do communicate with them.
In my personal business, my phone is my lifeline. Every since inception of my business, I've always had my cell phone on it, my house phone on it. I think that's important in my personal life. And now, as I've chosen to offer myself to represent you, I will do the same. I look around the room, probably over half of you have been to my house for something or the other. So, you know where I live. You're always welcome to come by and sit in the back and watch cars go by on Samples Road. I make myself very accessible to you as a citizen. And it's important, as one chooses not to be here tonight, to make him accessible, he had Gatorade, I did not. But You know, we've got to make ourselves accessible to you. I mean, that's so important as an elected official. And we all, you know, being a part of Rotary, being part of the many boards that we serve on, Michael's been gracious in the community. He's donated a lot of money to people over the past 6 months. I wish I had that kind of money to do that, but I don't. But, you know, I want to be fair to the people and make sure that you know where I am, that you can always reach me.
Lauren, do you believe state and or local funding should be used for charter schools or vouchers?
Yes, I do. I think it's important that we as taxpayers, that when we pay our taxes and we are paying the percentages that go to schools and those that have children in this community, that the money follows the child. Yes, we do have a great school system here, but there, as far as where we choose to send our kids to school, I think it ought to be our choice. And, you know, educating a child is a privilege, just like driving. It's a privilege. I can choose to send my kid to the public school system, a Christian school. I can choose to educate my child at home. And I think that's my right as an American citizen on how I choose that I want my child to be educated. Yes, I want him to be competitive. So that is important that we, as Forsyth County, we as the state of Georgia, keep the charter school amendment, keep it going forward so that our kids have the opportunity, how we see fit, to educate them so that they'll have a competitive advantage out in the real world as far as what they learn through education.
Yes, I 100% support school vouchers and choice. One of the things that I'm a big advocate of is free enterprise and competition. You have a school that's doing well, more parents are going to want to send their child to that school and they will receive more funding. You have a school that's underperforming, they're going to lose their funding because kids are coming out of their schools. I think that is a great model. It's worked wonderful for our country over the past 200 plus years. It would also work great for the education of our children.
We have another question in regards to state ethics. Michael, are the state ethics laws sufficient for ensuring honest and transparent government in Georgia?
No, I do not think they're sufficient at all.
Thank you. Where's mine? He might have spied on that one.
You're the first step.
Ethics complaint right there.
No, I do not think. I'm sorry, I'm distracted. Now, what's the question again?
Are the state ethics laws sufficient for ensuring honest and transparent government in Georgia?
No, I don't think so. And you can just read the newspaper, look on the internet, how many of our elected officials are still doing things that are wrong, are being taken to court, all kinds of stuff. So I know I've already talked about submitting bank statements and funding the Ethics Commission, but overall, no, I don't think that it's good here in Georgia.
Well, I think the important thing is we got to have more transparency. We got to know, as always somebody says, follow the money, you'll know where the evil is. And so it's one of those things that we, with our ethics laws, they have to be strengthened. But at the same time, I don't think pouring money in a department is the answer. I think the answer is what you're doing here tonight, is learning about Toucans. Toucans, and we've had breakfast together. We have breakfast every Tuesday morning together at Rotary. We may sit on opposite ends of the room, but we still chat. We met at Steak and Shake and had breakfast. So, you have good people that are offering themselves to you, and I think that's where it all starts.
He is absolutely right. It does start there. But something that I've seen, again, just in my short time doing this, is there is a lot of opportunities out there to do the wrong thing. And no matter what your character is, sometimes temptation just can become too great. And we need things in place to make sure that those type of situations are prevented to begin with, and if not prevented, then caught.
Lauren, did you have anything you want to add? All right, Lauren, you have the next question. Based on the current Senate rules, do you believe senators have sufficient time to read all the bills prior to voting?
No, they don't. I mean, of course, in the beginning of the session, yes, there's time. They've got to do a better job in the committee process. The committee process is where you filter a lot of these bad bills out. So as it goes on and bills are passed back and forth, amendments are added, of course, the session tightens and comes to a close. So in the latter days, right before signing day, the last 3 or 4 days, bills are just getting thrown in. And you don't have time to sit down and read every bill. And that's sad. That's sad that the rules are not allowing that process to take place. So yes, they do need to change that to a minimum of a 24-hour rule. As we talk about the Nancy Pelosi, you know, hey, pass it and we read it later. That's not right. That's not right for the people sitting in this room that's taking their time on a Monday night to come out here and listen to us. I think that as the next senator from Forsyth County, I want to make sure I change that. As we talked about, you know, caucus rules, there needs to be some changes to Senate rules too.
Yeah, I agree. 1 hour is not enough time. We need at least 24 hours to read over the bills. And my biggest suggestion would be to just stop passing so many bills. Legislation's only 40 days and it's designed that way for a reason. And if we don't have enough time to read them, don't send us so many, don't pass so many. So.
Michael, do you support the Georgia Personhood Amendment, SR 420, which grants personhood status to all innocent human life from the earliest stages of development until natural death?
Yes, I do, 100%. One of the responsibilities, one of the few responsibilities that government has is to protect the innocent and those who cannot protect themselves. Those that are embryos and fetuses, they need our protection and we need to be there to protect them.
You ought to sit down with a family that wish they could have had a child, that lost their child before birth. Or at birth, a mother that had carried her unborn child for 8 or 9 months. Unfortunately, I do it more than I want to. And to sit here and not protect that sanctity of life, I would fail everybody in this room. I would fail those many mothers that I've sat down and watch them cry as they're making arrangements for life that lived inside of her. And it's sad that we still debate this today. I mean, it's a person who, I mean, it's sad that it's become so political that we just don't do the right thing. And I promise, as a state senator, I will do the right thing.
Does the state of Georgia truly have a balanced budget?
Well, yes, it has a balanced budget. Because, again, it's required by law that we balance it. Yes, sir. Are there supplements that come from the federal government? Yes, a lot of supplements. And they're tied to Common Core. They're tied to transportation. And we've got to change that. That's why we have to have our constitutional convention. We got to change how we send our money to Washington. And I think that's one of the first things that I want to look at and be a leader in is making Georgia a leader in this nation and changing how money is distributed. And we send it north and then we get pieces of it coming back.
You guys already know my answer. I do not define it as a balanced budget. Again, I might be holding it to a higher standard, the American Institute of Certified Public Accountant standard, but according to the state legislative standard, it is balanced. One of the issues that, like I said, I mentioned, states have lost their sovereignty. They've sold it for this money coming from the federal government, and we need to do more to cut ties with our federal money to become more independent as a state in funding our own agencies and our own programs with our own dollars.
Michael, what role can the Senate play in helping Georgia become more competitive economically.
Let me first tell you that government does not create jobs. And if there's any politician out there who tells you that, in my opinion, they're lying to you. All the government can do is prevent jobs, or not necessarily prevent them, but put obstacles in the way. One of the things that just infuriates me is Tesla, who is a motor car company that's on the verge of cutting-edge technology. They want to put a $5 billion gigabattery plant somewhere in the United States. Here in the state of Georgia, we are only allowed to sell 150 Tesla cars. That is ridiculous to me. So what we can do in the Senate is to eliminate a lot of these regulations that we have in place that protect certain industries and certain groups, but yet hinder competition in the free markets. So if we can make Georgia more competitive by getting rid of some of our regulations, I think that would be great for us.
Same question, please.
Sure. What role can the Senate play in helping Georgia become more competitive economically?
Look at Forsyth County. Look at what we need here in Forsyth County. Great place to live. Y'all are all here because there's some natives in the room, but we chose to move here because of the quality of life. And I think what we've got to do as far as the Senate and legislators at the state level is stop the regulations, that's placed on us, even as individuals here in the county. I see it in my own business. I'm highly regulated in the funeral business and even having a crematory. We're tested. My staff is tested constantly. I understand continuing education. That's important in every job. But at the end of the day, we've got to cease the regulations and the burdens that are placed on us as businesses.
Now we're at the point where each candidate will be allowed to ask a question, and we'll start with Lauren.
Michael, I've watched you over the past 6 months, and I mean, we've, as I talked about before, Rotary in the morning, breakfast, and I want to thank you for offering yourself to public service. I mean, we both care about the county. We're both going around the county, visiting with each and everyone, hearing your concerns. But at the end of the day, my concern is living in this community, living in the state of Georgia, you've only voted one time on record in the state. What, tell me why that now is so important in 2014 to serve, and listen, you have that right to serve, because I think it's great we're both sitting up here having great debate, but why have you only voted one time?
Well, I've actually lived in quite a few different states. I've lived in Texas, Alabama, Georgia, North Carolina, Louisiana. So the reason why you only show one time here in Georgia, it's just the election cycles have been across different states. That pretty much is okay.
Michael, you have a question?
Yes. Mark Hamilton mentioned earlier that the best way to kind of predict future results is to look in the past. You've been county coroner before, and we've talked a lot about fiscal responsibility and budgets and all that kind of good stuff. And as a county coroner, in 2002, I believe you took office in 2001. In 2002, your budget was $68,000. When you left in 2012, it was $177,000, a growth of 260%. I know you gave back, was it 19% your last year, which is great, but the next year, person that came in actually reduced their budget by 20% as well. So how are you going to, control our fiscal problems?
Well, I look at when I became coroner in 2001, the coroner's office came in a box. It was about like a shoebox. That was it. 28 years of a coroner's office came to me as a shoebox. Had nothing to work with. I want to go back, the operations of the coroner system. It was, a funeral home took responsibility for a lot of the burden. The Ingram Funeral Home took a lot of the burden of what went on in the coroner's office. But I wanted the coroner's office to be autonomous. I wanted it to be on its own. So yes, it took some money. We had to get a vehicle, we had to get stretchers. Coroner's office had nothing. And of course, as time went on, the county fathers chose to start dividing out the infrastructure issues, that, you know, computers, the IT department. We were paying for a lot of all that, all the departments. So they added all that into the coroner's budget. I didn't have a lot. It didn't take much, you know, IT to go out to see if somebody was dead, but I paid for it. And so that's where my budget increased. Even today, though, the coroner's office is spending more money than I did in my last budget.
All right, well, at this point, we'll have closing statements. You'll have the same amount of time as you did for the opening. You'll have 2 minutes. And let's see here. Michael, you led us off on the opening statement, so Lauren, if you'll lead us off on the closing statement.
All right. Again, I want to thank all of y'all for staying here to 8:46. That means you care. That really truly means that you care. I want to thank Mark and Sherry for their good debate. I think it was great that Mark and Sherry both are offering themselves to y'all. Michael, myself, I want to thank Michael for being here. And you know, I too challenge Senator Murphy. We both will meet him anywhere to sit down and debate, and hopefully everybody else would come out and join that. This community's been good to me. It's been good to my family. The friendships that I've made over the 18 years that I've lived here will continue the rest of my life. This is home for me. I grew up in Commerce, Georgia. I'm a Georgia native, and this is where I'll die. And of course, it's something that I want to leave a legacy for my children. I want them to be able to look one day and say, my dad represented this community well. I'm proud of my father. You know, it's as a guy that has a small business in the community, I invest each and every day in seeing that this place gets better and better. I spend a lot of time at the park coaching kids and being a mentor. That's the most fun thing in my life. Offering yourself for public service is an opportunity. My business is ready for me to do this, and I want to make sure that I represent y'all from here, as we've talked about before. My ethics and my moral fiber is beyond measure. And you know, as you make your choice for your next state senator, I wish you would really look into the candidates and make sure that each of us have that same moral fiber. I love this place. I love Forsyth County, and I look forward to serving as your next state senator. Thank you all.
I also want to thank the Forsyth County GOP, Michael, for being here. And Lauren McDonald, last time we had this format, I was here by myself, so I'm glad to have Lauren up here. I think on Facebook somebody put on there that I was the cure for insomnia, so hopefully that's not the case tonight. I'm grateful for this opportunity to be up here to share some of the views that I have. One of the things I just want to close with is my goal is to represent you, the citizens of Forsyth County. I've been out there for probably about 9 months or so, knocking on doors, meeting people, talking to you in your living rooms, in your yard, all over the place. I don't necessarily have a desire to be a politician for the rest of my life. I've told so many people I'm not a career politician. This is something I feel like needs to happen, again, because it's personal to me, and I, for one, I'm tired of the way our federal government's been treating us, and what we need to do is to strengthen our states. That's one reason I'm running for state senator. I've already gotten the endorsement of several local grassroots organizations, such as the Homeowners Coalition, Fix Forsyth Traffic.com, Forsyth Citizens for Responsible Growth, Forsyth HOA and Homeowners, Post Road Committee for Property Development. I've been out there meeting you, talking to you, hearing your concerns, and I intend on continuing to do that if elected as your next state senator. Again, Michael Williams, I appreciate your time and your support and your vote.
Close here. I want to thank you for the opportunity to come up for Forsyth and moderate. It was my pleasure. I think we all know that we live in the greatest country on the face of the earth. It's a free nation, a nation where we can debate and share ideas and make good decisions and make our state a better. Thank you. Thank you.
Good job.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.